All right, so I'm outside of a 2020 Honda Civic hatchback, and this is the sport model. Very indicative, very sporty look. You'll notice the alloy wheels is gonna be a dead giveaway, and then the body liner that runs along the bottom here is a quick giveaway on this car too, to let you know that you're looking at a sport model. Now, as we move around to the front of the car, I wanna point out it does come with fog lights, so that's part of your sport model. You've got LED daytime running lights and your halogen beam headlights right there. I've got the car running here, so it's gonna be a little bit loud. I've got a smoked out grill going here. I will point out up here though, you'll notice that there's a trapezoid cut out up there in the tent, and that's gonna be related to your Honda Sensing, I'll point out. And then you actually have radar behind this grill right here. So we'll go over that when we get in the car, but I just wanted to walk you around and show you a couple things. You can see this front fascia that comes on the Sport too. So it comes with a really nice look to the car when we're speaking about things of that nature. Now in a Sport, I'm gonna pop open this door here and just show you. You've got a nice cloth interior right here with leather down the sides, leather right here, leather here, and a leather steering wheel. And we'll go over more than that in a minute, but I just wanna point out some of the differentiators from the LX model that you're gaining by going to the Sport. Now, I will point out while I'm here that the car does have keyless entry, so I can walk up, put my hand on it, it'll automatically unlock, or I can lock the doors by pressing this. So I don't have to get my keys out of my pocket, which is a really helpful feature. Now, when we get to the back of the car, it does have two spoilers. It's a definitely sporty looking vehicle. So when you're looking at the hatchback, I really like it for those reasons. And then you'll notice it has the nice centered exhaust down here, which is really cool too, which is only found on the hatchback version. So I'm gonna pop the back open here to show you a couple things. Your backup camera is actually right there, so just so you can see it. And you can see I'm here at Howdy Honda, so these guys are letting me show this car off right now. Now in the back, this is a piece that this dealership has added right here. So this doesn't come standard in the car, but I'm gonna show you what's below it here, just so we can get to it, is your spare and your jack and your accessories. So your spare is down here, it's full diameter, meaning full height, just not full width. So it's bigger than, let's say, a donut, and it does have a spare, which a lot of cars don't come with them. You'll notice there's a funnel right here. This is in case you run out of gas, and I'll show you that here in just a second. And your accessories as far as getting your jack and everything running. Now, I will point out down here that you can see it is set up if you need to put car seats in the back, on the left and the right, or if you want to put it in the center, you can pop this tab out, and that'd give you an anchor spot. Now, you do have some privacy things you can work with here, so if you want to flip that over, you can keep this covered, and then you do have a cover right here additionally too, and this is tinted, so there's absolutely no reason anybody should have to see anything in the back, in case you've got luggage, you've got your laptop, or whatever it may be. So it's just nice to know that you have that privacy if you need it. So let me push this down here. And we'll show you some other features. It's yelling at me because I have the key right now outside the car. Now, when we're talking about the gas cap, make sure the car is unlocked here. Pop this open because it is connected to the door locks. So it is capless, meaning that you don't have to worry about, you know, keeping that on there nice and tight. And if you don't, that the, you know, like you'll set up a check engine light. But if you ran out of gas, you could see how that would be an issue to get gas in there if you just had a water bottle or something of that nature. So that's where that funnel comes into play. And you can actually see there's a little warning right here. So you put that funnel down in there, and then you could pour gas with whatever you were using to do so. Now, I didn't mention the engine or the CVT transmission, but I want to pause and just take a second to do that. You're getting 180 horsepower, 1.5 liter turbo. So it's about 5 more horsepower than if you were in any of the other models. They're all turbo to engines in the Civic hatchback. And then a CVT transmission, 4 disc brakes, 6 airbags, 2 front, 2 side, 2 full curtain. I just like to touch on these things. We're gonna go over them in the car too. Apple CarPlay, an Android Auto, USB ports, push button start, keyless entry, all that. So a lot of this we're gonna go over together here, but I just wanna make sure I go through this so you can pause it in case there was something specific that I didn't touch on or you wanna look at. Now, related to pricing, including your destination, that's your MSRP right there. If you're looking for gas mileage, 29 in the city and 35 on the highway, gets you combined to 32. And then your overall crash rating is a 5-star crash rating, and you can see down the line there. So I always like to show those things, and if you're wondering where these cars come from, they come from England, so it takes a little bit longer for them to get here than some of my other vehicles. So, let's look in your back seat here. So, spacing-wise, you don't have a ton of space to work with, but you've got a good enough amount that you can get a 6-footer behind a 6-footer. And then you'll notice, again, you have the leather on the sides, the cloth in the center, and the leather in the dead center of the car, too. So it's kind of nice. And then they have added the all-season floor mats, but it does come with carpet floor mats for the car. On the sides here, you notice you do have some additional speakers in the car as part of the Sport model moving up. And as you climb models, you gain more speakers. So just be aware of that in case you're looking for more speakers. You can take advantage of that. Before I hop in the car, I will show you a couple things. One, it does have remote start. To use it, you'd press the lock button and then press and hold the remote start button to crank it up. It'll run for 10 minutes. If I want to extend that, press the same sequence again. It'll run for 20 now. Or I can press unlock and the remote start to turn it off. And then this isn't powered. This just unlocks the trunk in case you just want to pop that one portion to get into it. And then if you want to set up the alarm for the car, right? So that way we have an understanding of the key and how it works. It is a fob. So as I pointed out earlier, your seats, or excuse me, I didn't point this out earlier, it is not a powered seat in this model. So just be aware of that when you're looking at it. It's a manual adjustment here, and then you got a bar down up front. Over here, I've got my window controls, so auto and up down on my driver and passenger side, window locks, door locks, mirror control. So I don't think much explanation needs to be done there. So let's hop in the car here and go over some features. Turn the AC down here so you can hear me. So it is 100 degrees here in Texas, so I've had the AC pumping as much as I could just to make sure I'm not sweating on everything while we're doing this. So I will start here at a couple different features you can see. The first one is my road departure mitigation. So that works in the sense that if I'm driving down the road and I start to drive off the shoulder of the road, what it will do is it'll be an audible alert, and then it'll actually start to vibrate the steering wheel to be like, hey, wake up, pay attention, be aware of what's going on. So you can tell if it's on with that LED right there, whether it's on or off. Now, these next two features are always on and running unless I press and hold those buttons to turn them off. Now, my first one is gonna be my collision mitigation braking. So what that is if I start to look like I'm gonna rear in another car, it'll give me an audible alert. After the audible alert, it'll flash on the dash, and then it'll actually start to apply the brakes to prevent the accident. Now, next to that, you're gonna see vehicle stability assist. So this is the car with the squiggly lines right here. What that is if I'm losing traction, like going into a skid, it's gonna transfer power to whichever wheel is getting better traction to help correct the skid. So that's the focus of that button. Those two, I can't really see a reason to turn either one of these features off, but you have the ability to do so. You just have to press and hold on them. So if you wanted to turn like this one off, press and hold. And now it's off, right? So you can see I have to press and hold. I have to hold it for a little while. So you can't just accidentally bump this and turn it off. So if you're worried about that, don't worry because of the placement of the button. Now moving on to the steering wheel, show you a couple different features here. So we'll start you on your Bluetooth. So answer a call, hang up a call, voice command. So if I want to say call or text this person, that sort of thing. What's cool about this car is it does come with Apple CarPlay and Android Auto, meaning that if I have that hooked up, which what I would do is hook my phone up to the USB that is coming out right here. It actually runs down underneath and connects over there, if you can see that. And then once I've connected it, it'll light up and say Apple CarPlay or Android Auto here. And then I would just select it. It gives me access to my music, my messages, my navigation. But also, let's say I'm an iPhone user, I have access to Siri. I could press and hold this button until I hear the beep for Siri and then ask Siri to do things. Hey Siri, send a text to this person, call that person, you know, pull up directions to this. I personally like using Siri and Google for those options because I feel like their voice recognition system works better than Honda's. Not that Honda's is bad, I just like the use and connectivity. I can take advantage of those, right? So this is a multi-purpose button. Now this I button right here is gonna affect what shows up in the screen up here. So as I press that I button, you're gonna see different things here. So what was just showing was my, you know, tachometer info, or excuse me, not tachometer, but like my trip info, so tripometer. So range, how many miles on this tank of gas, average fuel consumption, that sort of thing. I can jump over one. This is gonna be related to torque. So if I wanna keep an eye on the torque related to the car and how I'm driving, I can do so. If I want my oil life, I can see that here. What's cool about this is when you get down to 15% oil life, it'll actually give you an alert. And then it'll throw a code for you, A1, A2, or B1, or B2. I like this because what it's going to tell you is you can Google that, or you can look it up in your manual if you want. Honda's been doing this for years, but it's going to let you know what they're going to recommend you when you get into the dealership. I think that's fantastic. That way, if you're worried about getting upsold or anything like that, you'll know ahead of time. So it just, you know, helps keep you honest or them honest and make sure that you're doing what you need to, so you can kind of know ahead of time. All right. So as I toggle through again, you notice I can jump over to my audio. And as I do that, it actually flips over to the auto screen where it's here. So if I had audio going, just to show you how this works, let's get just some normal audio going. So I'm gonna switch over the source and just go to like FM. What's cool about this is I can use the left and right. Woo, the audio's going, let me turn down the volume here. I can use the left and right to jump between my favorite stations. So, and as I do it, it actually shows me visibly on the screen there. And then I'll get it here too. So you can see myself toggling through different screens. So I just like that I can see it everywhere. So if I glance over, I can see where I'm at in relation to, you know, oh, I'm on number 10 of my 12, right? So you can see 11 now, 12, and then it'll jump back over to 1. So it's just kind of nice that it does that. So that was my audio option, and then I can jump over to my Bluetooth if I've got that connected up, which I haven't connected one to this car. And then if I need to switch between kilometers an hour or miles per hour, I can do it right there. And then my general I button, this is just like an informational screen. It would give me alerts like if the trunk wasn't closed, if a door's open, if my seatbelt's not on, that sort of thing. That's where I get those alerts right there. So that's how I, you know, just toggle through, select, and then select enter when you want to select one of the screens you want. And it'll actually keep that screen up if I want to keep that while I'm driving. My volume control is going left and right, jumps between favorite tracks or stations. Up will actually go between sources, which is kind of cool. I didn't show you earlier. So you can see if I could toggle through. Right now you should see FM and AM, but I'd have USB, Bluetooth, any of those other options that I have connected up in this specific car when I'm driving. So it's just kind of nice that I can quickly jump between those. So that's the left side of the steering wheel. Now over here on the right side, I have some additional Honda sensing features. So if I hit this main button, you're going to see ACC and LKS pop up here, right? So ACC and LKS stands stands for Adaptive Cruise Control and Lane Keep Assist. So Adaptive Cruise Control is just like your standard cruise control, but you can set distances it keeps between you and the car in front of you. And how it detects those distances is using this camera up in this box that I pointed out earlier and the radar down in the grille and the Honda emblem to detect the cars out in front. So if I press this button right here, it'll select boxes. The more boxes, the more distance it's gonna keep between me and the cars in front of me, which is cool. So when I get up to my speed, I press set, and then where it says ACC off right now, it'll say my speed. So it's a 65, and then I can select that distance it keeps between me and the cars in front of me. So you can pick that just depending on what your comfort level is. I like it just because if I'm taking a long road trip, I don't have to worry about somebody getting in front of me and me having to turn it off, turn it back on, mess with all that. Now, if you're saying to yourself, hey, I just want classic cruise control, I don't wanna mess with all that, if you just press and hold this button right here, it'll flip over and say cruise mode selected. Now it's just a classic cruise control and I would just use your set, cancel, resume. If I want to flip back, press and hold, and now I'm back to the adaptive cruise control. So easy to toggle between the two. Now the next feature is Lane Keep Assist, and that is this button right here. So when I press this button, you're gonna see some dotted lines appear up there. So what that's doing is it's gonna start using the camera that is up in this box to detect those lines down on the road while I'm driving. Now, once I'm going over 45 miles an hour, it'll actively start reading the road and those will fill in solid. Now, once it's done so, if I start to drift to the left or the right, it'll keep me centered in my lane. So if I'm using my blinker to get over, obviously it's gonna let me over, but if I'm not, it's gonna assume that maybe I'm drifting because I was distracted or what's going on, and you'll just feel a slight pull of the wheel to the left or the right. It's not overpowering. It's like if you've ever been in a car that has a little bit of a pull to it, like an older car that pulls one way or the other, that's what it feels like. You can easily overpower it. In case you're worried about, hey, what if it's about to be an accident and I need to quickly get over, you would be fine, don't worry about that. But that's kind of how this feature works. If you're someone who doesn't use your blinkers a lot, maybe this feature will annoy you, or maybe it'll get you to start using your blinkers, which we would all appreciate. Now, behind the steering wheel, you've got paddle shifters. So you can see a plus and a minus where I can up and down shift the car. And what that does is it just offsets the ratios of the car in which it's shifting because it's a CVT transmission. What that means, transmission related, is that there aren't set gears. It's not like a 5-speed or 6-speed car. It uses a band around these two cones and it builds up tension on the band as you want to increase torque. So this just allows you to affect that. So that was way more explanation than you probably need other than, you know, positive, hey, I want to shift up, I want to shift down. That's all you really need to know if you want more control over the car. Maybe you're driving it in the sport mode over here, right? So that's that. Now moving back over here, I want to point out you do have your fog light controls, or excuse me, fog light controls right here, and then your auto on off headlights right here. So I'm mixing up the two. So remember your headlights. If I want them on auto on off, where I can get out of the car and it'll turn off for me, or I can just, you know, do it manually if I want. And then my fog light controls, that's on where the hash mark is matched up or off. Now on the other side, I've got my windshield wiper controls. Control the front, just pull down. You need to control the windshield wiper on the back. It's gonna be on this blinker strip right there. And then to throw some juice out onto the front end, just pull towards yourself. So that's how you do that as far as, you know, cleaning off your windshield. So that's kind of the steering wheel rundown. All right, so let's go over the touchscreen in this vehicle. So I'm gonna start you off on the audio and walk you through everything. So if you touch the audio button, you'll see the source button pop up here in the top left, and this will give you all your audio options in this vehicle. So you've got FM, AM, you've got the USBs that you can plug into. So right here on that runs actually to down back behind here, if you can see it. So you could plug in, whether it be a thumb drive to this, or you could plug your phone in if you wanna use Apple CarPlay or Android Auto for that sort of thing. So. USBs, anything with an I/O plug into it. You've got Bluetooth, Pandora compatibility. If you're a Spotify listener, no big deal. You can always go through Bluetooth and listen to Spotify off your phone, or you can go through Apple CarPlay and Android Auto to be able to listen to, you know, any of your platforms musically. So I'm gonna back out of this screen. So you've seen this and you can just kind of jump around and do your normal touchscreen things and you got all your presets down here at the bottom. So easy enough to understand. Now, jumping down one screen, I'm gonna go to the info screen right here. This is where you can access some of your tripometer information if you want. So whether you wanna see that info here or you wanna jump over to the steering wheel where we were looking at earlier, you can see that info there. So just two different places you can see the same info. Also from this screen, there's a couple other things you can see. So if I'm gonna touch it again here and look at my options, you know, if I wanna clock and wallpaper, I can throw a custom image up here if I want, or I can select one of the saved ones. I'll show you where the saved ones are, and this is the same steps you would take if you wanted to add your own. So I'd go to clock and wallpaper. And here I'd go, yes, next, I want to change it. And then from here, if I plugged in my USB, I would be able to upload an image to choose from when I flip over to wallpaper. So you see add new would be right there, right here at the corner, and I would be able to do that. But for this sake, I'm just going to show you one of these, set it, hit okay.
and now it'll hold that screen for me. So it's just, you know, if you want to change the screens out, some people like to customize it. So it's just kind of a cool way to do things. So that's the info button right there. Now under that Honda Link, the big proponent I should say to this is that when you first connect up a phone to the car, it's going to prompt you and ask you, you know, as far as, you know, connecting to Honda Link. And what that's for is that in the event that you get in an accident and the airbags deploy, Honda will try to call down to you. If you don't answer, they can send out EMS to you, and they'll have the year, make, model, VIN, and the last, you know, GPS location of the car. So it's just a much more helpful and free service. So that's Honda Link. They additionally offer some features of being able to start the car off the phone and to do the door locks off the phone, depending on the trim level of the vehicle you're looking at. If you're curious to learn more about that, you can go to HondaLink.com and check it out. So that's what that is. Now, phone. If you've never connected up a phone to this car, first time you do it, it'll prompt you, would you like to add a phone? You'd hit yes, make sure your Bluetooth is on, and then search for that, right? So easy enough to do. If you were adding a second, third, or fourth phone, it's not going to prompt you like that. So from there, you would want to go to settings, and then under settings, go to Bluetooth and Wi-Fi, and then from here, I want to go to the device list because I want to add something to that list. You can see I can add up to 2, 4, 6 devices, and I would just hit add device, same thing. You know, turn on your Bluetooth and search for that. So that's how you're going to search to set up like a second or third phone or anybody else's phone if they want to hop in the car and play music or anything like that. Now, under settings, there were some cool features here that I always like to show people under vehicle. So if I go to vehicle, I want to show you some stuff about your door locks and windows and different things of that nature. So I'll scroll down to door and window here and select it. Now, under door and window, the first one you're going to see is auto door lock. So what that is when you hit 10 miles an hour, the car will automatically lock the doors for you. That's what the default setting is on every Honda. You can set it to when you shift to park, it'll lock the doors, or you can turn it completely off. And then back, auto door unlock. So the way it's set up right now, all the default on all Hondas is when you open the driver's side door, it's then going to unlock the remaining doors of the car. So you can see what's set up. You've got some different options here you can change it to also. Door locks is one of the common features I find that people want to play with and change and adjust whenever I was going over this with customers. So the last one is down here at the very bottom, walk away auto lock feature. What this is, if I have the key fob with me and I walk, get out of the car and I get 10 feet from it, it'll automatically lock the doors assuming I have the key with me. So I can't lock the keys in the car, one, because it's a smart key fob. But two, this is just assuming, hey, maybe I forgot. So if you're the person who gets halfway into the grocery store and you realize, oh my God, I think I left the car unlocked and my laptop's in it, this is a feature you're going to want to turn on. The default is to have this feature off. So whenever you get a new car, that's not going to be on. So just keep that in mind. And that's walk away auto lock feature, and you want to turn that on, right? So those are the three. Just to how to get back to those really quickly, hit settings. From there, I'm going to go to vehicle right down here. And then door and window, second from the bottom. And then the top two are the door locks. And if you scroll down one, you'll see walk away auto lock right there. So just three key features that I find people find very useful. And inside of here, there's some additional features you can play with if you want, as far as, you know, hearing the answer back when you hit the deal to, you know, to beep at you, like when you lock the doors and different things you can play with. But those are kind of the big three that I find most people want to change. Now, smartphone connection, this is what I was talking about earlier, Apple CarPlay and Android Auto, where you can use the voice command button to hear Siri or Google and do different things like that. And then you could access your music, your messages, your maps, so Apple Maps, Waze or Google Maps, depending on what platform you're coming from. Super fantastic feature. It's a reason enough for me to want to move from the LX up to the Sport to gain this feature right here, just because it offers a lot of connectivity through your phone and allows you just to access those features and really take advantage of using your phone in the car and integrating the two. So really fantastic feature, especially when it comes to music, which I'm always listening to when I'm riding around. And then, of course, navigation, because half the time I'm going places I don't know. And all you do is, you know, connect your phone to the USB right down here. And if you're an Apple user, this will light up once you've gone through the prompts for it. If you're an Android user, you do need to download the Android Auto app, which is in the Play Store, and it's 100% free. So that's how you connect up. All right, below that is your climate controls. This is one of my few knocks on this car other than the view out the back window, which I'll show you right there. So you can see it's not a great view, but if you're used to a hatchback, it's not that big a deal. My second knock on this car, if anything, is gonna be the climate control feature right here. The reason I say that is if I turn the car off and turn it on, I've gotta wait for this touchscreen to load up to be able to turn my AC on, and I'm not a big fan of that. I can kick up the fan and get it blowing cold air, but you know, if you live in a really hot state or cold state, sometimes you wanna get the air moving quicker. Now I can use remote start to get the car cooled off and kind of go that route. But I'm one of those people who just walks out to the car and cranks it up. So if you find yourself not using a remote start that often, this can be a little bit of a pain in the butt because I can't just immediately turn the AC on and get it going. I can turn the AC fan on and I can make sure this is turned down, but I can't control whether the AC actually is on or off. So I just be using the fan at that point. So my one knock about this car that I'm not a fan of. Your AC controls are right here. So how much air, hot or cold, and where you want it to go. Below that, you've got your shifter right here, so your park, reverse, neutral, drive, sport. So sport is just the S right there. That's just gonna, It's going to raise the RPMs that the car idles at and give you a little bit more get up and go. But you're going to give up some of your fuel consumption using that. So keep that in mind. Miles per gallon is going to go down when you're in sport mode. Now, the opposite of that would be the econ button over here. So if I was using that, I would turn this on. You'll see a green leaf pop up here, here, and here. And that's letting you know that it is active. And what that is it'll give you better gas mileage, but it's a give and take system. So you're going to give up a little bit of accelerator off the pedal. So you're not going to take off and go quite as fast. And then, of course, you're also going to give up a little bit of the AC power. So you're going to lose out a little bit of the AC control. So if you live in a super hot state, maybe let the car cool off, then you turn this on. But you can turn it on and off as you go. You don't have to be at a stop or start or anything like that. So it's kind of nice. You can kind of use it at will. Now, over on the other side, you've got your parking brake right here, which is electronic. Just lift up to set it. You can see the red LED lets you know it's on. And then it will actually throw a signal down there in the corner. And then to release it, just press down and it releases. Now, brake hold is set up for stop and go traffic. So what this feature is if I have the car in drive and I hit the brake hold button, you'll see it pop on up here, and then it'll alert me and it'll tell me it's holding. So you can see them over here in the corners. Brake hold's on, and then it says hold. So that means it's holding the brake, so I can let my foot off the brake while I'm in drive, and it'll hold the car. Then I would hit the gas, it'll release it automatically. I move forward, you know, my 4 or 5 feet in traffic or in a drive-through line. I come to a complete stop again, it holds for me. So that's what the function of this feature is. It's really a convenience feature, just set up to help you out if you're in like bad traffic or if you're in like a drive-through line. Just keep in mind though, you do have to have your seatbelt on to use this feature. If I disengage it, it'll just throw the parking brake on and turn that feature off. So just be aware of that. Now, your center console right here, it is sliding, so I've got shallow cup holders, and then if I've got a super deep well here, so if you carry on a big water bottle or anything like that, maybe you're super athletic or, always active or in a hot state, maybe that's something that's important to you. I like this. It slides forward for my shorter drivers. That way they can still get their elbow on it, and it does slide back, and it pops open too, so I've got a lot of storage space in here. The only thing that's kind of a bummer is it doesn't completely cover if you had something to hide, but you do have, you know, your storage here, and you can hide stuff in the back with all the privacy and everything. So that is your center console. Other than that, it's your normal new car stuff, what I call it, you know, your mirrors, you know, controls of this nature. You don't have a moonroof in this car, you'd have to climb a model to get that. And then, of course, your black interior. The sports always come with a black interior, and you see it has the racing stripe down the center. Black across the tops is in all my cars, and then this is going to be black to match my interior here. And then you can see they threw down some all-season floor mats in this particular vehicle. So next up is going to be the test drive. After the test drive, I'll give you out my contact info in case you have any questions. But on the test drive, we're going to go over a couple different things here. So we'll go over, you know, is it better to jump up a model, go down a model? What's the takeoff like? What's the road noise like? Give you an idea for power, go over some safety features. And then, of course, if you want to reach out and ask me any questions, you absolutely can. So coming up next, the test drive. All right, guys, so I'm inside of this 2020 Honda Civic Hatchback Sport. Now, we just went over the interior and exterior of the car, and now we're gonna go on a quick test drive just to go over some of the features of the car, how it rides, what the power is like, and then talk about, you know, hey, the models above it and below it, are they worth jumping up or down to get? So, initial takeoff, it is a turboed engine. It's got some pickup, it's great. The amount of torque that you have in this car related to the weight of the vehicle is fantastic. And then the fact that it's a Civic, it's smaller, it's really maneuverable, and it's just set up a little bit different than like your classic Civic. So I feel like you're gonna have a little bit better grip on the road and be able to really tear off. So let me give some gas here and you'll hear some noise. So you can hear that, I'm now up to 60 that quick, so didn't take me much. My window's down though. So related to torque and getting off the road or getting up off the line, you've got plenty of that. So that shouldn't be an issue. If you need to get onto the highway, you should have no problem getting on quickly and up to speed. As far as the noise that you'll hear though, if you're not used to a CVT transmission, you may have heard that where it really revs up. You don't hear it like drop down gears like you would in what a classic car for most people is. So you don't hear that wah, 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 that kind of sound. CVTs are a little bit different in that setup. It's not gonna hurt the car though, that's just what it sounds like. So you'll notice that, but I kind of like it. Makes you feel like the car is a little bit meaner. It's not a, you know, you're not gonna win a lot of drag races, but this car does have some get up, and it's gonna let you know about it, right? So as we come around this corner, I'm gonna get my lane keep assist set up here. So that's gonna keep me centered in my lane. And that way, if I start to drift to my left or the right, once I'm going over 45, it'll start actively reading the road here. So let me get up to 45 here so we can get reading the road, and then we'll get it actively going here.
Now, what I love about this feature is if I get distracted, you know, if my coffee spills, my dog jumps on me, my kid's doing something funny, I have the ability to, you know, whoa, you know, something's going on. It's going to keep me centered, which is what it's doing right now. So I'm keeping my hands kind of floating over the steering wheel here just to be safe. But it's really nice. It's keeping me centered right in my lane. If I start to get a little bit to the left or the right, it'll correct for me. Now, if it loses track of the road, it'll say steering required. And it's also going to do that, and you'll hear a beep here in a second, which you probably just heard, just to make sure, hey, make sure you're paying attention to what you're doing, right? So just kind of reminding you, hey, in case you were distracted. But a fantastic feature. It works really well, and it's there to help prevent an accident. Now, as I continue to grab speed, I'm going to set my speed on my adaptive cruise control and set my distance that it keeps between me and the car in front of me. Now, the cool thing is I have these plus and minuses on where it says set and resume, which will allow me to increase or decrease the speed without messing with, you know, turning it off, pressing the gas, getting up that speed, and things set again. What I really like about this feature is I can relax my foot, I can take a long ride, or road trip, I should say, and if somebody hops in front of me because they need to get over or whatever, it's just gonna slow down, keep my designated spacing that I've picked, and it's gonna allow me to continue down my journey, and then when I get out from behind, that person will take me back up to the speed I wanna be going, and I continue on without having to mess with turning cruise control on and off or things like that. So it's just a really cool feature. So right now I have it set to 80. There's a car in front of me. It's keeping me, my spacing, we're going 65, right? So the feature works really well. So if you're the kind of person who's gonna be driving a little bit longer, as far as maybe your commute, or if you find that you're taking a lot of road trips in this car, this is a fantastic feature to have. Now it comes in the sedan and it also comes in the hatchback, but I'm guessing if you're looking at the hatchback, maybe you want that extra storage in the back, and that plays a role for some portion of your life, or you just think it's a sportier looking car, you want the turboed engine, and you would just prefer it, right? No big deal. So safety features on the car works great. Now, road noise. What I will tell you is in this particular model, the Civic in general, the road noise is gonna be a little bit louder than if you were in like an Accord. If you're comparing this to like a four-door Civic, they're gonna be pretty much comparable. But what I will tell you is that I feel like the suspension is a little bit tighter on this car, and I think it is for a reason. One, because it's a sport model specifically, so it's gonna be a little bit tighter than the others. But just in general, I think that the hatchback is a little bit tighter suspension. So you're gonna feel a little bit more of the road. That could be viewed as a positive or a negative. I like feeling the road. I want to know that if I jerk the steering wheel that I'm going to get over and I really feel like I'm in touch with the road and I'm not going to lose, you know, I'm not feel like I'm floating or bobbing around on the road. This is a great car for that. It really feels like it sticks to the road and moves. It has great maneuverability. But if you're someone who's, you know, not concerned about that, but more thinking, hey, I want a nice, smooth, quiet ride, well, then maybe this isn't the model for you. So just something to keep in mind. I wouldn't say that it's excessively loud or excessively bumpy, but if I was going on a 17-hour road trip, I would much rather be in an Accord than I would be a Civic, right? Just for the sake of you know, quietness and smoothness of ride. But with that said, if you're thinking or comparing this to other you know, versions of the car, whether it be a Ford Focus, an Elantra, you know, a Forte, or anybody else who makes a sedan, or maybe they make also a hatchback, this car's gonna be fine. I think you're gonna find the road noise is comparable, if not maybe a little bit better. So I don't think you're gonna run into that kind of issue comparing it to other relatable, comparable models. So just something to be aware of. So as I come back around here and we kind of head down the home stretch, let's talk about the models below it and above it. So the model below is your LX model. That would be the entry level model of the car. As far as what you're gaining coming up to this car, I think it's really worth it. The exterior of this car is beautiful. I love that it has that nice larger wheel to it. It's got the body spoiler kit that wraps around the front and the sides of the car. I think it really gives this car a good look. It is definitely a huge step above a base model when it comes to the exterior of the car. Now, when you move into the interior of the car, I like the cloth and leather mix. I think that's fantastic. I love having a leather steering wheel. It's just a good feel. Leather shifter, leather center console. It's just a good feel on your body. But then the technology portion of the car. I love having Apple CarPlay and Android in my vehicles. I'm a big proponent and big supporter of those two. I love being able to pull up my music, my messages, my navigation. I constantly have my run in my car. So you know, if I was moving into a newer car, I would 100% expect it to come with that. So if I was looking at a model, let's say I'm cross-shopping with, you know, somebody else and they don't offer it, I'd be a little bit let down. For those reasons, I would jump from an LX up to a Sport and pay the additional income. I think it would be worth it, in my personal opinion. Now, if you're looking at the Sport and thinking, hey, do I get Sport or do I go up to the EX model? This is a little bit different conversation because the EX doesn't look as sporty on the exterior wise, but maybe you're okay with that. Maybe you feel like the Sport looks a little bit younger than what you want. No big deal, you can go up to that EX model. And you'll also get a moonroof, you'll still get the touchscreen, yes, just, you know, solely cloth interior. So it makes some changes that they're a little bit more conservative on that end of the thing, the spectrum, I should say, which some people might actually prefer. And maybe they want the moonroof or sunroof. They're going to be the same thing in this vehicle. They're going to open, correct? But those are just considerations to make. Me personally, I think the Sport is a fantastic buy. I think it's a great amount to, I should say, I think it's worth the money to pay to get above that LX model. Now, going from the Sport to the EX, I don't know that a moonroof necessarily is going to set my world on fire, having maybe heated seats. You know, those things aren't the best for me. There's a couple other features you're going to get, but, you know, none of them really sell me on spending another $2,000, right? So from that standpoint, I would rather stay at the Sport model just because I feel like it gives you the tech you need in the car. The exterior is a beautiful look to it, and it has everything that a person could need, in my opinion. Now, if you have other needs, you need leather to be in the car, you could look at two different ways. You could go up to an EXL, or you could add leather to any model. The dealership that I'm borrowing this car from, Howdy Honda, they actually have a third party that does it. A lot of dealerships do. So know that you don't necessarily have to jump up a bunch of models if you just need leather in a car. I ran into that a lot with customers thinking, hey, I really don't want to spend $30,000 to buy a leather-based model of an Accord, a Civic, or whatever it may be. I just need leather and some basic functions. Know that you have options other than that. Now, this isn't direct through Honda what I'm talking about right now, so be aware of that. But if that's something you're concerned about, no big deal. Now, with everything said, I think this is a great buy. I think this is a great car. You know, I don't like the climate control being connected to the touchscreen, and the view out the back isn't the best. But if you can get past those two things, I think you're looking at a really awesome car. It's got great performance, it's got a great look on the outside, and the interior also some tech that I really think is nice. As far as the seat and things like that, I'm a 6-footer, I fit in this car. I'm about 250, so I'm a bigger guy, and I fit in the car fine. So if you're thinking I'm a bigger guy and I'm not in a fit, no worries there. You should probably be pretty good. I can drop it back. So I'm all the way back, and I've still got plenty of space here. So if you're 6'2", 6'3", you know, if you're getting up to that 6'5 and above, maybe you want to look at an Accord. I don't know. But I would say check it out, see what you think. Other than that, if you have questions, feel free to give me a call or an email. If you want to shoot me a text, that's fantastic too. 737-443-9555. I don't mind talking with you. I'm not afraid. You know, shoot me a text, give me a call. If you want to email, because you're just more comfortable with that, no big deal. Shoot me an email. The letter J and then F. So Justin Fuller, JF, underscore 1064 at Yahoo. So other than that, you can always comment on the YouTube video. I'm more than happy, and I'm usually paying attention on there. I love getting feedback, and I'm actually gonna encourage you to do that. I would love if you could subscribe to the channel, one, because that would be awesome in case you want more info on Hondas or, you know, anything related. Two, I hope that you liked the video. Click the like button. And three, comment. If there's something you wish I would've went over, something I would change, or something in the future you'd like me to go over, I'd love for you to let me know what that is, because I'm always looking to produce new content. I'm always looking for ideas. And you, as the people out there shopping and looking at these cars, you might need the help. I know a little bit more about them. Let me share that with you. So comment, like, subscribe, do all the things. Let me know what you want and what you want to see, and I'll talk to you soon. Bye, guys.